You know, so now we've talked about all the drugs that are in clinical trial, the newer candidates that are moving closer and closer to clinical trial. We will not stop doing that, not stop filling our pipeline until we have the cure. And that's true, when I say we, I mean all of us working together, as we always do. These are some of the things that are coming newer to our treatment pipeline. There's another effort to use this ultra-high throughput screening capability at the National Institutes of Health that Rob Wilson was so successful with. In this case, it's Merrick Naparala, who is at the MD Anderson Clinic in Houston, Texas. He has developed an assay that's just been accepted into the NIH program that will be testing, again, 350,000 compounds on his assay. Whereas Rob Wilson's assay was a mitochondrial function assay, Merrick's assay is a frataxin gene expression assay. So if there are any molecules amongst those 350,000 that increase the production of the frataxin gene to make, you know, frataxin protein, his assay will glow. And so we're very excited about that, having that capability. Now that we have one that tells us if a mitochondrial agent might be beneficial, this one would tell us if an agent, for example, would increase frataxin protein expression, for example, the HDAC inhibitor. If our HDAC inhibitor were put amongst those 350,000 compounds, it would glow because it's going to increase frataxin protein expression. But there might be 10 other kinds of molecules out there that can help us do that. So this, we're very excited about this assay. And we, they can, believe it or not, screen these 350,000 compounds in a matter of a few days. Because they have two robots, one that goes to the inventory, hands the second robot, one of these compounds at a time, and he puts them on the assay. I think each well plate holds like 1,300 different molecules, and he puts them on 1,300 at a time and sees, you know, which ones glow. So we're very excited about that approach. There's another such assay being developed at the Mayo Clinic in the United States. In this case, it would show which compounds are effective or promising in increasing frataxin protein levels, whether it's by getting the gene to express more protein or whether, like EPO, it's able to keep the protein around longer, or we don't know how EPO is giving us more protein, except we know it's not making the gene express more. So if there are other compounds like EPO out there, this assay would help us identify. So on to the next thing. We do have very exciting gene therapy work going on. This is a full collaboration between a lab in Madrid with a lab in Oxford, a lab in the UK. And this is work in which BabelFamily and FARA are collaborating to support Dr. Michaela Lufino.
Yeah,
and
with Ataxia UK also.
And Ataxia UK,
yeah, and
FARA Australasia, and so
and
once again,
as well, we
right,
see.
Mm-hmm. So
we're all in this together. This is all of our associations.
Yeah, and come together. This is marvelous, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly. And we were just talking with Dr. Lufino last night about getting him together with the Australian scientists that are doing our stem cell modeled work, and there we've just given them a grant that we'll talk about in a minute to go from cell model development from stem cells to a stem cell therapy in FA. And so we'll get our gene therapy experts together with our stem cell experts and see if we can accelerate their progress together. In fact, let's jump down to stem cell therapy. We have wonderful teams in four labs in the world that are working together and with all of our associations. There's the Ellen Puccio lab in Strasbourg, Joel Gosfeld's lab in California.
Okay, stop your mic. Great, okay.
So let's go to this very promising work that's going on now in stem cell work for FA. It began with four labs around the world that all of our associations have been helping support. It's Ellen Puccio's lab in Strasbourg, Joel Gosfeld's lab in California at the Scripps Research Institute, two labs in Australia. There's Morella de Torre and Alice Pibe. The effort began with a wonderful discovery in Japan of a scientist who figured out how to take a skin cell, a fibroblast, from a patient and derive from that skin cell, believe it or not, induced pluripotent stem cells that then can be nurtured into the cell of choice to make a cell, for in our case, a neuron and a cardiomyocyte, a heart cell and a nerve cell that we've never had, that those cells will have Friedreich's ataxia. The cell work we've done to date has been mostly in blood cells, and blood cells are not a good manifestation of Friedreich's ataxia. That's not where our disease happens. So we knew from the beginning it would be much more effective to do those experiments in a nerve cell with FA or in a heart cell. Now we finally have such cells, and that would be remarkable enough to know that we finally have one that can be used to do our basic science experiments, but more importantly, to screen promising drugs. Now, instead of always having to go to blood cells to test an HDAC inhibitor, and then go to our mouse models, which takes a long time, and our mouse models are not yet perfect. They do not fully reflect Friedreich's ataxia in humans. We now have nerve cells and heart cells that will be able to fully reflect FA in those tissues and be used to screen drugs. That's wonderful news in and of itself, and now this lab in Australia, Elise Pibe's lab, we've just given her a new grant, just decided last week, to take the next step, which everyone has always wanted us to take, but it's very forward-leaning, very high risk, but high benefit. That is, not to stop at a cell model, let's go to stem cell therapy. In her case, she says, okay, I'll take the fibroblast, the skin cell, I will induce pluripotent stem cells from that, and then instead of nurturing or deriving a neuron,